Hapidae, welcome. Thank you everyone for coming here tonight. The National Park Service for making this venue open for us. The Humanities Council for sponsoring and advertising. It's just a pleasure to see so many people out here interested in Chamorro history and archaeology. We have so many things to talk about today. My part will be short, just talking about what we've been doing recently at Laulau Bay and about the earliest archaeological sites in this region. And then we'll hand it over to Professor Peter Bellwood to talk more about the big picture of Asia-Pacific archaeology and how Chamorro archaeology fits within that big picture. So let's get started. You know where you are. When I lecture to other people, it's that people just don't know where we are in the Marianas, but you know where we are. This is just to show you, it's isolated, you know, compared to other parts of the world. That red line you see there is what we call like the boundary between near Oceania and remote Oceania. Going east of that line, you would need to be at sea for a while, outside the sight of land for some time in order to reach the next islands. In the case of the Marianas, it's more than 2,000 kilometers from the nearest place that was inhabited at that time, at about 1500 BC, when people first came to the Mariana Islands. And that's the very first time when anybody lived successfully in this region we call remote Oceania. So as an archaeologist, this is very exciting, you know, finding, you know, the first time any human beings ever lived in this region of the world is quite exciting. And in fact, there's a number of sites. I won't talk about every single one of them, but they're in the larger islands in the south end of the Marianas Archipelago, these larger islands, mostly limestone formations, which have the most mass, you know, the most food resources as well as water resources that are caves, streams, or other places. And that's probably what was most attractive for people to come live in these places at 1500 BC. You know, you need a place where you could have reliable food and fresh water. And I'll be talking about Bellwood site at the north end of Laulau Bay today. That's what's shown here. Now, Bellwood, many of you probably know the site. It has some large lati ruins on the surface that were occupied certainly during the 1600s and for a few hundred years before that. But as you dig deeper beneath the ground, we've been finding these other buried layers that are much older than the lati. In fact, very old as 1500 BC. But that's very deep beneath the ground. And we're not the only people ever to excavate there. You know, people have been excavating there since the 1970s. I myself excavated back in 2005 as part of nominating the site for the National Register of Historic Places. And it is on the register now. And now we're back again to focus on that deepest and oldest layer because it's so rare to find that. And there are, you know, at least 8 sites so far that we found of this age in the Marianas. If you compare that age versus the hundreds of lati sites that we have, the ratio is quite impressive. And we need to learn more about this oldest period. And that's what we're doing now. Just to show you, I've been talking about these radiocarbon dates and the age in 1500 BC. These are the sites that we know with radiocarbon dates of that age. And that line is approximately 1500 BC. And as you can see, the Bellwood site really is the oldest that we can confirm by radiocarbon so far. It's actually slightly older than 1500 BC. And so that's another reason we'd like to focus more on this particular site in Saipan, to learn more about that old date and what made this place so special to people and so attractive at that very, very early time. And this is just to situate you, you know, in Saipan. If you haven't been around Laulau Bay, it's all the way in the north end past the dive area. And another view looking down, that's the road going up to Kagman there. Back in 2005, the Historic Preservation Office was very supportive and helpful with clearing the site. I'm sure many of you know what it's like to clear areas of jungle and revealing the Lati sets beneath it. And there it is. It's actually one of the nicer Lati sets that's in an accessible place in Saipan. Very, very impressive, as you can see here. And then in our 2005 excavation, we had not very much time, but as you can see, the staff were very helpful. We got as many people out there as we could to help with the excavation, and I'm just so grateful all the people who could help back then as well as now. And let me show you, this is just a sample of what the excavation looks like. This is how we start, measuring out the area and slowly going downward one layer at a time. And just a very simplified version is something like this, these different layers of clays and silts and sands. And as you go deeper, of course, they're older. And we find different types of pottery, in each layer as we go down, that also are indicative of different time periods. And other clues in the environment, like the about the kind of shellfish people were eating, and even the sediment itself tells us something about the sea level change and other things happening in the environment. So the upper part, which is associated with the Lati, really is the latest part of this site. And as you go deeper, things are very, very different in terms of what the place looked like, what kinds of food and resources were available, and what kinds of artifacts people were making and what their daily lives would have been like. All of those things changed rather substantially over more than 3,000 years of people living at this site. And again, just very simply, this is like a side view of what it looks like now, fairly far from the ocean in a stable environment that's safe from typhoon surges and other things. But at 1500 BC, it looks more like this. It's actually quite close to sea level, it would have been covered by high tide events and certainly by typhoon surges at 1500 BC. So a very different kind of lifestyle and different reasons why people would have gone there at 1500 BC versus today. And now I'll show you just some of the artifacts from that earliest period that we found back in the 2005 excavation. So there's shell beads and bracelets and armbands. These pendants that are made of shiny shells. This is unique. This is a piece of coral that was made into a pendant. So there's never been another one like this found. A piece of Anadara shell. Anadara is a kind of clam shell that lives in swampy environments that you don't see many of them today. They existed primarily during this old time period. And then when the sea level changed and the habitat changed, then these kinds of shellfish just did not survive. That depression there is like the size of my thumb, going in it, just to give you an idea of the scale. Again, sort of it's a unique artifact. We don't know exactly what it was, but we know it's unique. And debris from making different kinds of fish hooks, you can probably see the shape in there and imagine what people were trying to make in this case. Different stone tools, I like this one in particular. It's a chert, which is a high silica content stone. It's almost as sharp as volcanic glass. This was heat treated and then polished, made into an adze, which is like a wood cutting tool. And most important is the decorated pottery. I don't know how well you can see this, made with these dentate stamps and circles that are stamped into the pottery when it was wet and then fired. And this is very, very distinctive. Dentate stamped pottery is a marker of a particular context and cultural group. So to find this in an ancient Chamorro site is very important. This is the kind of thing that previously was known in the Lapita world, in other parts of the Pacific, and then more recently found in parts of Indonesia and the Philippines. So this is something showing us a link with other regions around the Asia Pacific at 1500 BC, which would have been the first time people are moving into this region. So this is a very distinctive thing that allows us to make these cross-regional connections. I mean, now we'll talk a little bit about what we're doing now, currently in 2016. So these are some fresh pictures. We've just gotten started excavating again. And so it's, you know, clearing the jungle again and measuring out our area of where we're excavating and stripping off one layer at a time. So we've just now been going through the uppermost layer, which is the most recent, and that's what's associated with the Lati period occupation. So far we've been recovering, you know, that kind of thick pottery that you see in many places around the island that's associated with the Lati period. And we have so many people out helping us, working so hard from the Historic Preservation Office, and many of them are here with us tonight, so I just want to acknowledge all of their hard work and everything they're doing to make this project a success. And part of what makes it a success is not, you know, Dr. Hong and myself working, it's the group, you know, it's the team. You know, we're all learning from each other about this project. So it's, as you can see here with these pictures, just giving you an idea of what we're doing and carrying the soil little by little through a very fine mesh of wire screens that we find everything in there. And when we do find things, it is quite, you know, exciting. We get, you know, to touch, you know, something from that period and wonder, okay, what was this, who made it, and why, you know. Now I want to revisit about this pottery. I mentioned how it's a very distinctive thing, but it's found not only at the Bapot site, it's found in a number of places. Here's some examples of what we found a few years ago at the Taga House in Tinian, and maybe you can see some of the same technique and even the same design is on there with the dentate stamping and the circles and even the motifs that people are creating with those elements. Here are others that are found at the Rediscovering site in Guam, and again, maybe you can notice the same things are appearing again. But it's not only in the Marianas. Here's some examples Dr. Hong excavated from a site in the northern Philippines. And again, you can see there's really no doubt that these things are related in some way. And when we look at the big picture of the Asia Pacific, we can trace this pottery trail, you know, moving from Asia across into the Pacific. The oldest of it we find in Taiwan, at least as early as 4000 BC. Not this same type of pottery, it's something different. And then about 2000 BC in the Philippines, and then in the Philippines is where we first see that very finely decorated pottery like you just saw. And then about 1500 BC is the first time this really explodes out into new places, including some other parts of island Southeast Asia, so a few sites in Indonesia, as well as in the Mariana Islands. So this is the key part for us, is that 1500 BC. And then after that is finding that decorated, then dentate stamped pottery in a place called the Bismarck Archipelago, just east of New Guinea. And then Lapita pottery expands out into other parts of Melanesia and West Polynesia, like New Caledonia, Vanuatu, Fiji, Tonga, and Samoa. And for the longest time, you know, Pacific Islands archaeology was taught from that perspective of Lapita. And now we know the Mariana Islands and Chamorro archaeology is actually in this crucial part of being the first time people were living in the remote Pacific and using this specific type of decorated pottery. So that's really why we're motivated to come back to Bapot and do this new excavation to learn more about that earliest period. I'm sure many of you are thinking, you know, to yourselves, okay, what motivated people to do that? And if they came across 2,000 kilometers of ocean, then where did they go next, right? And what did that pottery mean to them, that finely decorated design? Those are the kinds of things that we're asking too, and we don't really have answers to them yet. And so with that, I just want to encourage you to think further. And of course, as I mentioned before, I've been just grateful of all the support we're getting from everyone while we've been working at these sites, not only from the Historic Preservation Office, but also from the Humanities Council and everyone we've met along the way. Now, I don't want to take up too much time. I would like to introduce our next speaker, who is Professor Peter Bellwood, who is in the world of archaeology, he's world famous, you know, for writing so many books about Pacific Islands archaeology and the big picture of Asia and Pacific archaeology and how they relate together. And much of the work that Dr. Hung and I have been doing in the Marianas is really following in his footsteps. You know, he long ago put together theories and hypotheses about migrations of Austronesian people from Southeast Asia into the Pacific, and the reasons why that should have happened, the dating, and we've, over the years, really just been confirming and refining many of his theories. And tonight he will talk more about the details of his work and about how Chamorro archaeology fits within that picture. So I'd like to invite Professor Peter Bellwood to the stage.
Well, good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and thanks very much for coming to hear the talk. I didn't expect to be here a few weeks ago, and this is my first time in Micronesia, my first time certainly in Saipan, and I also went to Tinian yesterday and saw the House of Targa. I'm actually in this part of the world because I was originally asked to go to Seoul in Korea to give a talk at a one-day meeting about a Neolithic site called Amsadong in the suburbs of Seoul. And because Seoul has direct flights to Saipan, I thought, well, that's a good chance to come here, because it's quite difficult to get here from Australia. You have to go through all sorts of places on the way. I did try to come here a few years ago when Mike and Hsiao-chun were digging at House of Targa, but the research grant that we shared sort of ran out at that unfortunate point, and I decided I better not go spending any more. Now, the title up here is probably not the one that's on your piece of paper, but never mind. This is the one that I gave in Seoul, because I'm going to talk about sort of deeper levels of things. You know, why did all of this start long before the Marianas were ever heard of course, on the mainland of Asia? And I will certainly be coming into the Mariana Islands here and there, particularly towards the end of the talk, although not in any great detail. Now, first of all, just as background, I originally, as you can probably tell from the way I talk, I grew up in the UK, and I studied archaeology at Cambridge University, and in 1967 I migrated to New Zealand and took a job as a lecturer in archaeology at Auckland University for the main purpose of studying the migrations of the Polynesian people, who always struck me as being very interesting because they were so intensely migratory, like the ancestors of many of you in the room right now, of course. And I spent about 6 years in Auckland, and then in 73 I moved to the Australian National University, where I took a greater interest in the islands of Southeast Asia, because it was pretty obvious, of course, by that time that the peoples of the Pacific had to come from Southeast Asia. I know Thor Heyerdahl, some of you will have heard of him, many years ago with the Kon-Tiki thought that people settled the Pacific Islands from the Americas, but that was wrong. I mean, I'm not being mean. It was wrong because we have now so many data from genetics and linguistics and as well as archaeology that we know that the people of the Pacific essentially came from Asia. So there's no argument about that anymore. But in the last few years, I've expanded my interests far beyond Southeast Asia and the Pacific, and I've become interested in many things in the world, particularly the rise of farming and the migrations of human species, going right back, of course, to the original out of Africa events, which are around about 2 million years ago, not involving our own ancestry, but certainly involving the ancestry of other kinds of hominin who are now extinct. And I take, I suppose, a worldwide comparative view of this. So some of the topics I'm interested in, and these do concern the Marianas Islands, ultimately, certainly the developments of food production in different parts of the world. Of course, food production developed in the Middle East, in China, in Mesoamerica, in New Guinea, West Africa, the Andes, possibly other areas as well, but those are the major ones. I'm also very interested in what happened when people developed food production. They grew their populations. Now, when populations are growing, people eventually fill places up, and there's always going to be some pressure for people to go and find land somewhere else. That, of course, is probably the root of human migration. Migrations also rely on having open doors in terms of land bridges or environments, but you do have to have a growing population to make migration worthwhile. If the population is shrinking, no one's going to migrate very far or very successfully. And of course, when populations do occupy new territory, then you have the expansions of archaeological complexes like Lapita, or people coming to the Mariana Islands, and also language families. Well, certainly language families in many occasions of hunter-gatherers, but the ones I'm most concerned about are the language families of people who have developed agriculture. They include families like Indo-European, Austronesian, Sino-Tibetan, and so forth. And in order to study all of this, I try to use many different sources of data. I'm an archaeologist, and I do study the archaeological record, but it is impossible to make coherent sense of what happened in the past without thinking about human languages, human biology, genetics. And I do have to say that nowadays, the science of genetics, or genomics as it's often called, dealing with the autosomal genome rather than mitochondrial DNA, genomics is now a huge area of expansion. And some of you might have read in the pages of Nature just a few days ago a new report where people have found ancient DNA in Lapita people from the Western Pacific, from Vanuatu. Several individuals living about 3,000 years ago, the people who made the pottery like the pottery from the early pottery here, and those people have mitochondrial lineages and autosomal signatures that track them back to the Philippines and Taiwan, which is very, very important. This is new data. This is all brand new research. Scientists are now learning how to extract DNA in tropical latitudes from human bones. So that's leading to a huge potential development. Now, and number five, okay. Well, of course, when we're considering the human past, you've got two aspects. One, of course, is this factor of migration that spreads new entities, if you like, or new ways of doing things, new kinds of humans. When they've spread, they begin to differentiate in terms of their phylogeny or their shared ancestry. But also, in places where humans were there beforehand, they will mix with the preceding populations. Now, don't forget here that places like Australia, New Guinea, and Southeast Asia were settled by humans, modern humans like us. I'm not talking here about Homo erectus, but modern humans like us settled more than 50,000 years ago. And they've always been there. And of course, the modern peoples, or the modern indigenous peoples of Australia and New Guinea, are fairly direct descendants of those early migrants. People who speak Malayo-Polynesian languages, including the ancestors of Chamorro, are different and have, of course, a much more recent ancestry in Asia. But much of Pacific archaeology is about the admixture between those two populations. Now, during my period of all this research, which goes back almost 50 years now, I suppose, I've written several books about the Pacific, obviously, but and also books about human migration and beginnings of farming over on the right. But I would just say that at the moment I've got a book in press which is a rewrite of this one. This one was last published 20 years ago, so it's now out of date. And there's a new one I've got called First Islanders that Mike and Hsiao-chun both have contributions to, that's coming out with Wiley Blackwell early next year. It's all about the archaeology of the islands of Southeast Asia. It isn't specifically about the Pacific, but it will mention certain aspects of Pacific archaeology. Now, why did people spread into the Pacific? Well, we know, of course, that the first people spread 50,000 years ago to Australia and New Guinea. They got to the Solomon Islands. They probably got to the southeastern main Solomon Islands. They didn't get much further. They didn't get here. They didn't get to Vanuatu or Fiji or New Caledonia, probably because, of course, they couldn't build boats that had sufficient capacity to cross such wide expanses of sea. Why did people spread into the Pacific later and come to the Marianas? Well, if you really want to get to the deep roots of things, long before the Marianas were, as I say, thought of or settled, you have to go back to the beginnings of agriculture in China, because that is probably what drove the demographic changes that led people to move southwards, to settle in Taiwan and the Philippines, and to develop the lifestyle of ocean going in canoes and agriculture. They were farmers. They didn't just live on fish and shellfish. These people were, in the early days, and they were rice farmers too, the beginnings. Now, rice might have come to the Marianas. It's the only place in the Pacific where it probably did have rice in prehistoric times. But in Southeast Asia, much of the early layers of migration were driven, I think, by rice and probably also millet farming, as well as the other crops like yam and taro and bananas. But it is the cereals like rice and wheat and maize in the Americas, of course, that led to the great populations that in other parts of the world we associate with ancient civilizations. The Mayas, the Aztecs, the Egyptians, the Sumerians, and so forth. They were all farmers of cereals. That was their essential way of life. Now, rice developed in central China. Unfortunately, this particular machine does not show the shading that I had on that map originally, showing where rice was first domesticated. It's up at the top, and it's sort of the Yangtze River and northwards. You can just see a very faint dotted line. That is the northern limit of wild rice early in the Holocene, about 10,000 years ago, quite a lot further north than it is now, because the East Asian climate was warmer. The monsoon was stronger then, after the climate warmed after the last glaciation. And some of those dots up there with numbers on them represent the oldest sites that we have that involve rice production. Now, one member of our team, and he's here now, is Jianhua Deng from Beijing. He's here in the room, and he is working with us on trying to recover phytoliths from the Unai Bapok site. Phytoliths are little tiny microscopic fragments of silica that exist inside the stems of plants, or trees, or cereals, or crops. And when those things die, they fall into the soil, and they're preserved, and they can be identified to the species that they came from. And Jianhua has been working in some of these sites in China, particularly the one number 7 up the top there, a site called Baligang in the Han Valley. But to cut a long story short, the upper sites, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, have the oldest evidence for cultivated annual rice. I won't go back, there's no time for me to go into details. This is a very long and complex story. It's the short-grained rice, the japonica variety, as botanists call it. The Indian long-grained rices were domesticated a little bit later in the Ganges Basin, and there's a separate homeland of rice in West Africa as well, but that's a different species. And then it spread south. The first sites at the top there that we find with domesticated rice are, I suppose, well, of course it took a long time to develop, but around about 5,000-6,000 BC, when domesticated characteristics appear in the rice. Then it spread southwards, reaching Taiwan by maybe 3,000 BC, something like that, adjacent areas of coastal China. In the Philippines there, you can see a site called Andarayan. We have rice remains from there that are probably about 3,500 years ago, or 1,500 BC. Took a while to spread south. But it certainly spread with human populations, and I'll come back to that in a moment. We know it spread with humans because we have an awful lot of skeletons, and you can see major changes in the skeletons through the time period concerned. Now, so rice is very important. It's not the only crop. They had millet as well, and of course tubers, as I said, you know, taro, bananas, sugarcane. But I think rice was, to a degree, a driver of a lot of demographic increase, which I'm going to come on to in a minute. Now, just to be brief about rice, on the left, you can see, I think, two kinds of rice. There is the perennial ancestor at the top, Oryza rufipagon. Over about 3,000 years, between, let's say, 9,000 and 6,000 BC or something like that, in central China, because of human selection, moving it from permanent wetlands into seasonal wetlands. That led to the development of the domesticated annual cereal, Oryza sativa, which is the modern rice that feeds half the world, for very good reasons. It's a very, very important plant. Over on the right, you can see some scenes from daily life in China at 5000 BC. Just little things to think about. At the top are a series of timber stilt houses from a site called Hermudu, down near the Yangtze Delta in northern Zhejiang province. Of course, you all have your latte here. Now, the latte are not as old as 6000 BC. But they are the same idea, presumably, here in coral stone. Houses on stilts, of course, are found all over Southeast Asia, and they have an immense antiquity. Then we have a canoe, a 6,000-year-old... it's 8,000 years old, actually, 6,000 BC, that canoe, partial canoe from a site called Huahu Chiao. Wonderful woodwork, the world's oldest woodwork. Egypt has a lot of woodwork in all of those pyramids and things, but they're nowhere near as old as 5000 BC. The oldest woodwork in Egypt is mostly pre-dynastic, and it's about between 4 and 3000 BC. The peoples of central China were creating remarkable timber carpentry 6 or 7,000 years ago, and that, of course, is how they built their boats. You know, planks lashed together, edge to edge, to build them up. There's a huge boat buried next to the Great Pyramid in Egypt of that kind of construction, 4,600 years old. But also, that kind of construction with edge-to-edge planking on a dugout base probably was the foundation of the boats that brought people here 3,500 years ago, no doubt without riggers and sails as well. But you have to have a hull, a high hull and a waterproof hull that'll keep you up above the sea and keep you afloat for many, many weeks. And pottery and earth ovens and things like that. These were complex cultures by many, many thousands of years ago. Now, one of the things about what we call China is, and I do have to make the point here, we are not talking about people like modern Chinese. We're not talking about people who speak Mandarin or something like that. These are people thousands of years ago who were the ancestors of many of the peoples of Southeast Asia, and their descendants live in Southeast Asia now. In China, the Chinese Empire, I suppose, since the middle of the first millennium before Christ, warring states, Qin and Han dynasties, they conquered China, and they replaced many of the languages and cultures of southern China with Sinitic cultural layers. But of course, in South China, you do still have a lot of minority populations, especially Thai speakers in the southern provinces. Not Austronesians. Austronesians only go back as far as Taiwan. But at some point in southern China, there must have been people who spoke ancestral Austronesian languages. They're not there now, because in Fujian and Guangdong, pretty much everybody speaks a Sinitic language as a result of language change in historical times. Now, China, but when I say China, I mean the geographical area of China, is immensely important because it has today one of the greatest, densest populations in the world, and it's always had that. This is the homeland of rice. This had huge populations going back thousands of years. And you can see this if you read the archaeological reports about Chinese archaeology. Now, I don't read Chinese, and I'm not a sinologist by training. But an awful lot of people write books about China in English. They get translated. So we have these fine, detailed surveys of settlement patterns going through thousands of years during the Neolithic, from, say, 6,500 to about 3,000 BC. And if you look at some of those figures, these are mostly the Yellow River, but if you look at some of the figures going from left to right, you can see hectares and numbers of sites. Comparing the left column to the right, you can see enormous increases in the density, sizes of sites, and the numbers of people, presumably, who were living in them. Over those 3,000 years or so, this is very, very dramatic. It's one of the most powerful records of population increase anywhere in the world. I think it's much faster even in the Middle East or Mesoamerica and places like that. This is extremely rapid population growth. some more examples at the top, Manchuria, and also the Yangtze River, where we have similar, in Taiwan. Although the Neolithic is much younger in Taiwan and comes out of southern China, you can still see the same huge increase if you compare these middle and right columns. The left-hand one, there were no Neolithic sites in Taiwan in 6000 BC, but the numbers increased very dramatically. Now, it's not too difficult for me to think what might have happened here. I'll leave it to you to think about it. But we're looking here at possibly huge increases, and some archaeologists have suggested in some areas, I mean, over those 3,000 or 4,000 years, there might have been increases of up to 50 times. That may be a bit extreme, maybe 30, but even so, it's a huge increase in population size. Now, what did they all do? Well, of course, if you have a population that is increasing, where every family has way over two children, and life is pretty healthy, and it probably was in Neolithic times, they did not suffer from ill health. I think the rate of reproduction was very high. And that, of course, means that there will be a gradual spread of population into adjacent areas, moving southwards in the case of rice. They couldn't go very far north because of the climatic problem in northern China. It's too cold, but heading south was not so difficult. Now, that brings up, of course, the possibility of how rapidly can human populations develop, especially in small islands. This is a factor that I suppose affects the Mariana Islands as well. I should just mention one thing I was going to add before about the rise of rice in the Yangtze Basin. The spread of population southwards, I think, did not involve sort of direct migration from Shanghai to Taipei. There was not like the Julius Caesar describing the migrations of certain Celtic tribes where they all got together and thousands of them moved off into a different part of Gaul or something like that. These, I think, were small piecemeal migrations. And the Yangtze populations who were growing rice probably would not have been migratory in themselves because, of course, rice farming requires a great deal of labour input and it makes the land very valuable. I think we're looking here at sort of peripheral migration as increasing pressure in the centre pushes people outwards. There's nothing new about this. This kind of spread of populations has been and within a lot of the theorising about the spread of the European Neolithic, for instance, in a number of quite well-known works now, populations increase gradually. They spread along a front. The front is always admixing with existing indigenous populations, and it spreads outwards and outwards. And I think that's probably what happened in East Asia. But a few examples where humans do have an amazing ability to reproduce themselves incredibly quickly. And this is very important for archaeologists and very important for small islands. We know from a number of historical records, the population who settled Pitcairn Island, site surveys in the Hawaiian Islands settled about maybe 1,000 years ago or less. They had about 300,000 people by the time of Captain Cook or just before. Very, very rapid population increases. And of course, at the top there, you can see where do humans fit in all of this? Is it very slow reproduction, like elephants, or is it very rapid, like rats and rabbits? Well, of course, humans are special because, unlike other animals, we have the ability to vary our reproduction rate to extremes, either reducing it right down or to a very, very high level. And there are many cases in recent colonial history, in Australia, amongst the white population, Canada, where birth rates in the 19th century were incredibly high, 10 children, 9 children per family, and health was very good as well. So humans have an ability to increase their populations very, very dramatically. Now, I won't go into this in any more detail, but I think this is very important when we think about why did people come out to the Pacific? What really caused it? Did they just sort of fall into a boat and float away? Or were there other reasons involving food production and a need for land and of course the ability to build the boats and to catch fish? I mean, those are very, very important abilities as well. Now, I think here, if you don't mind, I'm going to move on. In the talk that I gave in Korea, I did talk about the shift to rice farming in China. And I discussed some of the topics that are involved. This, I think, is going to complicate things quite a lot. And I don't want to get into too much detail, because I know that you're a general audience and are probably not familiar with a lot of this material. I want to move now into, and this looks complicated too, I know, life is complicated. One of the things about archaeology, well, I'm a prehistorian, really. I trained in archaeology, but I'm interested in human prehistory. So I'm interested in the biology, the genetics, the languages as well. And once you get involved in all of those things, you find that scientists who do those things are doing some very, very complicated things. And you can't just, it's very often quite hard to summarize it without making it silly. This is biology. Now, this chart comes from a colleague of mine, and Hsiao-chun's, and Mike's, a guy called Matsumura Hirofumi in Japanese, but he, of course, the other way around for Western publications. And Hiro lives in Sapporo, and he's a very smart fellow with skeletons. He measures the skulls of the crania of ancient people. And then he puts it all in a computer and applies a multivariate statistic to it and produces these neighbor net splits tree diagrams. And this is actually very important because this is the most recent one that he's done. In here are hundreds of modern populations and ancient ones from ancient skeletons all over Vietnam and southern China and many parts of the world. Not yet the Marianas, but some parts of the Pacific. And there are two groupings here. One of them is this one over on the right. You see from that sort of separation up there, this group down here, these are all Australo-Papuan people. The modern ones live in New Guinea and Australia and some of the islands of eastern Indonesia and Melanesia, like Vanuatu and so forth. There are also many ancient populations in there, so-called Hoabinians from mainland Asia, lots of them. Even some Jomon people in Japan, Negrito populations in the Philippines and Malaysia. They all fall into this group of people whose crania, basically, and facial shapes fit best with the Australo-Papuan model, a population that still exists in very large numbers in the Western Pacific. The other group are what we might call Asian populations, especially Neolithic and later Asian populations, including quite a lot of modern Southeast Asian group, but also lots of Neolithic sites in Vietnam, Thailand, China, and so forth. And that population to the right is including up, of course, Northern Asia as well. You can see Mongolia and Yayoi Japan there. That population to the left, rather, is the Asian population which has spread, we know from other sources of data, within the last 5,000 or 6,000 years. And of course, it includes the peoples of the Pacific, the Polynesians, the Micronesians, all descend from that, well, the left-hand side of the diagram, the Asian Neolithic migrations that have led to modern populations in the mainland and islands of Southeast Asia. In other words, what's happened is that the first modern humans settled Australia, New Guinea, Southeast Asia, a very long time ago, 50,000 years ago, and then, during Neolithic times with agriculture, populations from the mainland of Asia have spread around them and through them, and not really into Australia or New Guinea, except in coastal pockets, but they've spread through Southeast Asia and into the Pacific. The same pattern comes out in this recent analysis of genomic DNA, that is the autosomal recombining DNA. And the people who do this, in this particular case, are based in Harvard University. This came out in Nature a couple of years ago. The essence of this, which is also complicated, I know, but the blue is what they call the Formosan ancestry component. It is the parts of the genome that were carried through migration through Taiwan into Indonesia and the Pacific. Not through New Guinea, as it's shown there. The arrow going through New Guinea is actually wrong, and I would have told them if I ever had the chance. Those people went north of New Guinea. They never went through the New Guinea Highlands in the way that's shown on that map. The other colours, the red, the orange and the green, of course, represent a mixture with indigenous populations who were there already, like the Papuans of eastern Indonesia, the Negritos of the Philippines, and other populations of western Indonesia who are related to ancient populations in mainland Southeast Asia. There's another change. I've been involved in a lot of research in Vietnam where we find very ancient cemeteries, often with hundreds of burials that could be 6,000 or 7,000 years old, long before the Neolithic in that part of the world. And always, the really ancient burials in Indonesia and Vietnam and southern China are like the ones on the left. They're tightly flexed or crouched. The crania, when the faces are preserved, are always Australopapuan. And they never have grave goods. They have Paleolithic stone tool assemblages that are called Hoabinian in mainland Asia. In the Neolithic, there's an example on the right from a cave called Gua Harimau in Sumatra. In the Neolithic, everyone was buried on their backs pretty much, sometimes in jars, but normally on their backs with facing upwards, supine position, and usually with lots of grave goods. Pottery, stone adzes. You don't find those sorts of things in the earlier Australopapuan burials. And here, there are a couple of burials, I presume a mother and a child, maybe a father and a child, I can't remember now, from a site we dug some years ago in northern Vietnam. It's called Man Bac. They date to between 2000 BC, 1500, 2000 BC. You can see here the adult has a stone axe and a pot. This is very typical of the Neolithic, what essentially comes out of southern China, where the oldest examples of these kinds of burials are found. But the importance of this site is that the craniofacial reconstructions and ancient DNA from the bones showed that there were two populations here. One of them, and the majority of the people, were Asian Neolithic, of southern Chinese origin. The others were Australopapuan. They were all living in the same site. They must have been intermarrying, mixing. But this site dates to very early in the period when, presumably, the Asian group had migrated into Vietnam and were settling amongst former, presumably, hunter-gatherers amongst the Australopapuan native population. So it is a very important site for that period of admixture. And of course, today there are many populations in the Pacific and Australia who descend from Australopapuan ancestors of the late Pleistocene. Negritos on the right and the Philippines, a young boy in northern Luzon, and many of the peoples of eastern Indonesia, the far eastern part of Indonesia, Timor and Alor, islands very close to New Guinea. On the other hand, of course, the majority, I suppose, of populations of places like the Philippines, Sumatra, Borneo, even Java, and certainly the mainland of Southeast Asia nowadays, are essentially descended from Asian Neolithic ancestry. These people at the top are Punan. They're very old photos. They're people in Borneo taken early in the 20th century. And the guy at the bottom is in Sumatra. The ones on the right are in the Moluccas. Now, the Chamorro, of course, belong to this group. Obviously, that is very obvious in terms of genetics and everything else. These are just one of the points about this early Asian Neolithic migration, the one that brought the people into the Pacific, is that it started along the coastlines of Asia. And it started originally when rice was being first domesticated in places like the Yangtze Delta and the coastline of southern China, Taiwan, and so forth. Now, Mike Carson, who's just been speaking to you, has been doing some very interesting reconstructions of the landscapes of the period concerned. And we know that when these populations were first developing the rice farming and beginning to migrate southwards, the coastal landscape was had just been recently drowned by post-glacial sea level rising, so that there was very little lowland. Lowland was very scarce, and if they were growing rice, they would have probably had to move quite a lot to find good land. And as a result, of course, they probably headed southwards and eventually found themselves in Taiwan and then in the Philippines. This is a reconstruction of part of the Yangtze Delta. The top of it is 3000 BC, the bottom is today. But if you go back to 6000 BC, there would have been even less land. You can see Shanghai up there. In 3000 BC, Shanghai, of course, was under the sea. So that means that when people were developing the rice farming, the suitable land would have been far less extensive than it is today. And Mike has shown that this is also true for Taiwan. The eastern part of Taiwan was being dramatically uplifted 5,000 years ago, such that it was a very, very steep coastline with a very long, probable offshore island. And nowadays, that island is joined to the mainland, and there's a valley in between. And there's much more flat land now. But when the first farmers spread into eastern Taiwan, they probably found a very steep, flooded coastline with a great shortage of suitable rice farming land. The same in the northern Philippines. Again, this is all Mike's reconstructions. The Cagayan Valley, where we find these wonderful sites with the pottery, just like the Marianas redware. The Cagayan Valley, 4,000 years ago, I don't know if you can see it at the top, was full of sea, shallow sea. It's all filled up now with sediment. And of course, the Cagayan Valley now is a great rice farming zone. The wet rice is everywhere, acres and acres of it, miles and miles of it. But 4,000 years ago, when Neolithic people arrived, it was shallow sea and not such a favorable landscape as it is today. Now, I'm just going to move quickly in the last period into the Taiwan and the beginning of settlement in the Marianas, as I think we see it at the moment. This is Neolithic Taiwan. What were they doing in Taiwan 5,000 years ago? Something like this. They were growing rice and millet. Plenty of the grains of those plants have been found. They had domesticated dogs. There's a complete one. Must have been a pet buried in a site near Tainan. Most of this comes from sites near Tainan. They made fancy pottery. You can see that some of it's actually red painted. And some of it, a little bit later, has a red slip, rather like much of the Marianas redware found here. They made bark cloth beaters and stone adzes and slate projectile points. They had weaving because they used spindle whorls for spinning fibers. These never really got into the Pacific. The backstrap loom got into the Carolines and Santa Cruz. I don't think it ever came here. But this kind of weaving with a loom, with a backstrap loom, doesn't seem to have been carried very far. They also had little knives made out of shell, item E, that they could have used for harvesting rice, because they were growing rice at this time. This is about this particular bunch of artifacts is about 2500 BC. By about 2000 BC, and this is mostly research by Hsiao-chun, who did studied all of this for her PhD at ANU, which I supervised in about 10 years ago, eight years ago now. By about 2000 BC, the pottery in Taiwan, especially southeastern Taiwan, becomes a rather bright painted red. They weren't stamping very much on it at this time, but those are big burial jars there. That big one you can see on the right had a child inside it, laid on its side. These are some of the oldest jar burials in Southeast Asia. They're about 4,000 years old. So red slip pottery, still rice and millet. Sorry, it's not a very clear slide. And now the very common appearance of this kind of vessel where you have a dish on a pedestal. These were not new. They're found in much older South Chinese sites, but they are part of the expansion into Indonesia and the Philippines. And I suspect they probably might also have been part of the expansion, although I don't think we find many of these pedestals in Marianas redware sites, as far as I know. But that's an issue for debate, perhaps. Now, that redware that comes in Taiwan about 4,000 years ago, I think you'll have to take my word for it at this point, because this again is fairly complicated. But this is again work by Hsiao-chun from a site called Xiaomar Cave in southeastern Taiwan near a city called Taidong, where she's shown that round about 2000 BC or 2200 BC, there was a great increase in the proportion of the red-slipped pottery. Now this, of course, is quite a while before people came to the Marianas, But we can see this red slip developing in Taiwan, sometimes with decoration, but not yet with the stuff that we see in the Marianas redware. This is architecture in the Taiwan Neolithic about 3,000 years ago, and archaeological material from the Batanes Islands, where I was excavating quite a lot between 2002 and 2007 with Hsiao-chun. This is in the northern Philippines. Basically, to cut a long story short, we can see a spread from Taiwan into the northern Philippines and Luzon round about 2000 BC. And you can see some of this Batanes pottery has the circle stamping on it that you see on the Marianas redware. But this doesn't have the dentate. That's not present in Batanes. It is present in Luzon. More about that in a minute. Now, this is very important. And I think this is, again, work by Hsiao-chun. Although these particular pots here come from a site called Magapit. It was excavated originally by a Japanese team led by Yoji Aoyagi, I think about 20 or 30 years ago now. Most of this material is stored, it's actually kept in Japan. But this is Magapit pottery that we think is probably 3,000, 3,500 years ago. And as you can see, it is quite intricately decorated. Mike showed some from another site called Nagsabaran. It's infilled with white lime, and there are combinations of punctate or dentate stamped zones between inside incised triangular motifs and zones, and rows of stamped circles, probably made by using a plant stem of some kind. And notice these two little ornaments here. That one's of stone, it comes from Magapit in northern Luzon. That one is of shell that comes from a site called Anaro in the Batanes Islands. They're both around 3,000, 3,500 years old. And guess what we found this morning? There we were, digging in Unai Bapot, and we excavating through the top layer that has the Latte period material. And in the underlying sand that we think may have been redeposited by a typhoon from carrying older materials from the beachfront, dumping them further inland, this popped out of the sieve. And at the moment, we are thinking that it is the same size, different materials, but there you have two of them from the northern Philippines. They're from Luzon and the Batanes Islands. Now, Mike tells me, or Hsiao-chun says there's one in Palawan, right? Possibly. There are others from the Philippines, we think. House of Targa, we think there's one as well. We've only just worked this out. We're still working on this. So this could be quite interesting. And this is from Unai Bapot. It's, about 2 centimeters long. It's a little ear pendant of some kind. It looks a bit like a fish hook, but it's much too small to be a fish hook. It's only 2 centimeters long. You couldn't catch a fish with anything like this. This is an ear ornament, which we think once hung in somebody's ear. Now that's a rather interesting link between the Marianas first people and the Philippines. And Mike showed you before a slide of comparing pottery. At the top, that is Nagsabaran in the Cagayan Valley, where you have the punctate zones and the stamped circles. This is from Aksugao in here, right, in Saipan? Or is it Tinian? Saipan, isn't it? Yeah. Where you have the same kind of decoration, circles. Here a rectangle filled with dentate stamping. And notice this Lapita sherd from New Caledonia. You have the same pattern, the circles and the dentate stamping in a rectangle. Now, I do have colleagues who work on Lapita who say, oh, it's all coincidence. It's nothing to do with anything at all. But I wonder how far you can push coincidence. There are some remarkable similarities between Marianas redware and Lapita pottery. Can we explain them? I'll come on to that in a minute. But I would also mention, while we're talking about this kind of pottery, it does also occur in Sulawesi, in one site in northern Sulawesi, but a site that I've been involved in working on with Indonesian archaeologists in west Sulawesi, Kamasi in the Karama Valley near the town of Kalumpang. You can see at the top left there a sherd from Kamasi, And the one at the top right is actually from Magapit in Luzon in the northern Philippines. And you can see that it's the same design. You've got the stamp circles, triangles filled with dentate stamping. There are minor differences, but essentially it's the same. Also, when you look at rim sherds, you find that in the early Philippines, southeastern Taiwan, and the early Sulawesi pottery, there is this curved form here. We found one of these this morning in Naibapot in the hurricane there. That could be interesting. And I would mention too that this particular site, Kamasi, does have quite a few phytoliths of rice. We're not sure how important it was, but the student of mine who worked on this did isolate some rice phytoliths in Kamasi, dating back to about 3,500 years ago. So it's possible that these people were growing rice as well. And we find similar kinds of pottery right across the islands of Southeast Asia at the time in question. I won't go into detail about that, but I will go into detail about this. In the last few minutes, where did Chamorro come from? Now, as you probably know, there's a lot of argument going on here. People write articles about which way do the winds blow and things like that. That's all very well, but that doesn't solve the problem. We've had recent suggestions that they might have come from New Guinea. Well, that doesn't work terribly well because of the obvious biological and linguistic reasons. The people of New Guinea don't speak Austronesian languages, for a start. Neither do they in the northern part of Halmahera and Moratai. They're all Papuan speakers. So it's a rather unlikely source of settlement for the Marianas. Some people suggest Sulawesi. Now, Sulawesi, yes, that's possible, I suppose, if you go through Palau and Yap. Don't forget the Carolinian atolls, 3,500 years ago, were awash. Sea level was higher then, so they would have been uninhabitable. They would not have existed. They would have been under the sea at high tide. So you would have had Yap and the Palau Islands, and of course Pohnpei and Kosrae far to the east, the volcanic ones, but the atolls were not there. Neither were they there in the Tuamotus and much of Polynesia. But Sulawesi, as you can see, is kind of hidden. It's hidden away in the middle of Indonesia, far behind the Philippines and Halmahera. It's a possible source, but I'm still kind of banking on the Philippines, I think, I have to say. And many years ago, I read George Anson, because, of course, one of his crew did that wonderful drawing of the House of Targa and the well in 1742. And George Anson was a bit cheeky. He somehow managed to capture a Spanish ship and found the captain's charts. And the Spanish captain had put on his chart the route from Manila to Acapulco. When they went to Acapulco, they didn't stop anywhere, because I think they were probably frightened that people would jump ship. But they went through the Marianas. They waited for the westerly wind, the monsoon winds that come sometimes from the west in the summer, in the rainy season. June, July, I suppose, at the peak of that rainy season. And they would follow a route, something, I put that route on the map deliberately, because they went through the northern part of the Marianas, according to the Spanish chart. So it has to be possible. Now, of course, they would be beating into the trade winds or across them. They'd also probably be carried north a little bit by the Kuroshio current. But that is a potential route, I suppose, for ancient people. Whether they ever crossed it, we'll never know. We can never know that, but it's worth thinking about. The rest of this map is a little bit complex. These dotted lines here show the spread of this early form of red slip pottery from Taiwan and the Philippines southwards to Sulawesi and Indonesia. And of course, it was a branch of this that moved off east to the Lapita sites of the western part of Melanesia and through into Polynesia. And as I said before, we now know that Lapita people were Polynesian. Their mitochondrial DNA in Vanuatu is Polynesian mitochondrial DNA. The haplogroup B4A. It's the Polynesian motif, B4A, 1A, 1A, whatever it is. Some of you might know about this, but it's a very specific tie between Lapita and the modern Polynesian population. Lapita people didn't come here, I don't think. Did people from here might have gone to the Bismarcks, because once they got here, heading south across the trade winds, especially in the winter when they blow from the northeast, might not have been so difficult. But again, we don't really know that, and probably never will for certain. A couple of years ago, I was in the National Library in Canberra, and I discovered some old charts. Here's an old sailing chart from 1872. It's never been published, but it was used by sea captains in the 19th century when they were still using sailing boats. And you'll see here the Kuroshio current that carries warm water up the eastern side of Asia, past the Philippines and Japan. But if you look across the Kuroshio current, you'll see that the little arrows up here, they all do a kind of, they all turn around and come back down. And guess where they come down to? So if you can cross this current and get into this area of water here, I presume you would probably be carried into somewhere into the Marianas or the island chain that extends to the north of it. And this is a winter wind chart showing the prevailing winds in the, this will be January, February, I suppose. They tend to come from the northeast. Whether that would help you to get to the Marianas from the Philippines, I'm not sure. It might help people if they were traveling from the Marianas down towards the Bismarck Archipelago, because that means the wind would be partly behind you. That's all we can say. At the moment, if we're talking about pottery, the closest parallels lie with the Philippines. Not just Luzon, but I mean, similar pottery has been found in other parts of the Philippines as well. Possibly Sulawesi, although that is a little further away and more remote. And of course, Lapita. Exactly who went where and what happened is something that we're not really sure about. But I wouldn't mind betting, particularly having found that little thing this morning, the little shell ear pendant with its Philippine parallels, that the first people to come here 3,500 years ago did come from somewhere in the Philippines. Somehow they must have got across. And if they did that, they would have crossed 2,300 kilometers of open sea. Now, we know Polynesians could do that because they did it many times to Hawaii and Easter Island and New Zealand. They did it within the last 1,000 years. But there's no real reason why Chamorro ancestors, or the first people to come here, couldn't have done it 3,500 years ago. We don't know what canoes were like then. They must have had lashed plank canoes, where you have sides lashed together on a dugout base, and they almost certainly, from linguistic evidence, had outriggers and sails. So in theory, they could have done it, but just as Polynesians reached Hawaii, New Zealand, 1,000 or 500 years ago. It could have been the same kind of process. I have mentioned Sulawesi. I'm very interested in Sulawesi. I don't really know if people came here from Sulawesi. I'm inclined to think not, but Sulawesi has some incredibly fascinating archaeology that's quite remarkable. It has a lot of these stone jars, but I think they're Metal Age. I'm sorry, they're in this compilation because this is from my latest book, and that is the way I've compiled it. But if you look at those things at the top, those stone statues, you will see some, the second one on the right, that's a female, I think, that one. She has breasts and the rest of the female parts, but she has her hands over her stomach. And the one on the right, who pretty obviously male, has the same posture. Well, of course, it's not difficult to know that the Easter Island statues have exactly the same. Their busts, they're cut off at the midrib or just below, and they have their hands across their tummies, and they look a bit alike. Now, I'm not suggesting that Easter Island people came from Sulawesi. That would be totally impossible. They're too far apart, and there's too much land in between them. But what and these, of course, were only carved in maybe AD 1500. They're not very old. They're just before Europeans arrived, the last 200 or 300 years before Roggeveen arrived in 1722. But the ones in Sulawesi are not dated. We don't know how old they are. They could be Neolithic. They could be 3,000 years old. If that's so, then the Easter Island and Sulawesi tradition are sharing some ancestral concept of how to represent a human ancestor on a stone platform, which goes back for thousands of years. And that's very important. The other thing about Sulawesi is that in the Barda Valley, there is this particular stone here. Now, I've never been here. I have friends who were here in 1982 and took this photograph. I'm going to use it in my next book. It's an incredible piece of stone on the left. You will see that it has a human face on the right with a pointed chin and a little mouth and something like a moustache and a couple of eyes. And to the left of it is a flower-like pattern of four petals with other petals in between. Okay, I presume that's all clear. It's called the Bulili stone. It's in the Bada Valley in Sulawesi. It is undated. It stands up apparently at the side of a rice field. One day I'll try and go there, but apparently there's no road and it's a hell of a job to reach it. On the right is one of the most famous Lapita potsherds ever found. That's the face sherd from a site called Nanumbo in the Santa Cruz Islands, southeastern Solomons. Recent redating gives it 800 BC, which is probably, I think, fairly accurate. Now, that motif on the right, on that pot, as you can see, you've got the face with the little moustache, its pointed chin, and the flower-like pattern, sort of a bit beyond where the earlobe might have been. Whether this is representing huge ear ornaments, we don't know. But essentially, it's the same motif. But of course, the one on the right also has all the stamp circles and dentate stamping, just like the Marianas redware and Lapita in general, and the Northern Philippine pottery. So something was going on here that certainly involves the Philippines, the Marianas, Lapita, and Sulawesi. Exactly how it all interrelates, we don't know. We think that, of course, once these migrations started, people moved very quickly over huge distances in their canoes. We know that obsidian from New Britain was carried all the way back to Borneo, about 3,000 kilometres, and that happened at about 3,000 years ago. So there was enormous amount of movement at the time, and one spin-off of that movement was certainly the arrival here in the Mariana Islands. Okay, just briefly, some further observations. Some of these are going to get fairly complicated. What I would say is that I think we're looking, in terms of the islands of Southeast Asia, three sort of axes of movement about 3,500 to 4,000 years ago. One of them was Formosa, through the Philippines into Sulawesi and eastern Indonesia. One of them was from Formosa into western Borneo, and then, of course, western Indonesia, the Malays, the Cham speakers of Vietnam, all a westerly movement, and with Malagasy coming out of Borneo, southern Borneo. The other one would have been this one, Formosa, Philippines, and then possibly involving the Marianas and island Melanesia. So they would have been three major movements of early Austronesian populations at the time in question. Okay, now I think I'm going to stop there, I hope that hasn't gone on for too long, and ask if you, I don't know, if you want to have questions or what the...
First of all, thank you.
Okay. There's a chairperson, it seems to be me. but Mike is here somewhere, I presume, and can answer questions if necessary. Yes, okay. Mm-hmm. Yes, okay.
You stated that the population migrations are due to the growth of populations. I assume that has something to do with the availability of food supplies.
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
There are other reasons why populations migrate. There are forces of nature that... for example, islands get flooded out, volcanoes erupt in later times.
Yeah.
Political considerations that make migration necessary. How do those figure into your theory?
Well, those would be mostly local, of course. I mean, on the scale of the Austronesian migration that covered half the world, individual wars or tsunamis or whatever would cause population movements like they do out of Syria right now. They're not going to explain the whole process of going from Taiwan to Easter Island and Madagascar. I mean, population growth is a basic underlying factor. What caused the population to grow, of course, is something else, but that would be the major factor, probably, in causing it to be successful.
Mm-hmm. With the ancient travelers, would they go against the current or with the current?
Well, we don't know that. I mean, the people have looked at the way people in the Carolines, you know, have been sailing canoes in recently, going between islands. You obviously, with a canoe, you can cross a current. I think most the wind is probably the most important thing. The current will move you, most currents are not really... The wind is probably stronger than the current, if you see what I mean. It's the wind that's going to determine where you're going to end up. Although if you lose your sails, obviously the current will then come into play.
How do you reconcile, you talked about the repeat of pottery between the evidence of it showing first in the Mariana Islands as opposed to the rest of the
It could have come through here. Lapita pottery to archaeologists is only in Melanesia because they define it that way. You know, the Lapita culture is the Bismarcks to Fiji. As you've seen, the pottery here and in the northern Philippines is so similar that you could call it Lapita. No one does. It is quite possible that people came from the Philippines through here and then went south into the Bismarck archipelago. I've always thought that is quite possible. We can't prove it. They could have gone through Yap and Palau, but there's no evidence from those islands that this kind of pottery has been found there yet. It might turn up. You can never know what you haven't found, of course. Things turn up and then things change.
But I have another question. I'm from here, mm-hmm. and I'm very interested in my history. I was wondering, because the Mariana Islands, we have had very few studies made of our islands.
Yeah.
And I think very little anthropological or archaeological findings have actually been made and much less published. And I was wondering how much of your theories are based on really just what you know now, and it may be totally wrong.
Well, that of course that's true of everything. Yeah. I mean, a lot of this theory does come from linguistics. I haven't had much to say about linguistics, there hasn't been time. But it was linguists who first of all realized that Taiwan was the homeland of Austronesian languages, and that everyone accepts that. No one really argues about that. They spread essentially from Taiwan, and probably initially through the Philippines, because it's the next place in terms of the map. Of course, everyone can be wrong. But eventually, the amount of evidence builds up. And if you've got several disciplines, like genomics, linguistics, skeletal analyses of craniofacial shape, archaeology, other domestic animals and their sources, where does the rice come from, and things like that. Once they start all pointing in the same direction, then the odds that someone one day will find something totally out of the blue, those odds become smaller and smaller.
Dr. Bellwood,
mm-hmm.
If for us, the migration of the distance that we're talking about,
yes.
to be able to establish a successful population,
yes, yes.
there would have had to have been some critical size
yes.
of that first arrival
yes.
to have enough
yes.
females giving
That's right.
birth to have a successful population.
Yes.
What would that critical size have?
Okay. Yeah, well, you're dead right. Of course, it is the number of women who matter. The number of men, as long as there's one, doesn't really matter. But the number of women, the number of young women... I'm sure you will all realize the significance of that. The number of young women is absolutely crucial. There must have been lots of young women. And the mitochondrial DNA through the Pacific, which is the female inherited DNA, is mostly from Asia. So they brought in lots of women from back in Southeast Asia into the Pacific Islands. Much of the Y chromosome DNA is Papuan. It comes from Melanesian males who must have been migrating also, mixing with, or marrying with Asian women of Asian deep ancestry. But how many people? Now, there was a woman called Norma MacArthur who died many years ago. She was a demographer. And back in the 60s, she did an experiment in the days when computers were fairly primitive. And she sort of works, I think she asked the question, okay, let's say we have three or four couples and we put them on an uninhabited island, what is the chance that they will survive into the future? And I've forgotten what answers she found, but some of them did survive. All I can tell you is that some of them did survive inside this computer. They didn't all die out. So it was something like only six couples. If you have six couples, there's a reasonable chance of survival. There'd be enough children born to have more children and keep on going.
Tertiary representation. That they would have lasted more than three generations.
Oh, yes. No, she did. She thought about that. No, she was thinking in terms of many, many generations into the future. It was in the Journal of the Polynesian Society, maybe in the late 60s, early 70s.
So an accidental arrival.
Yeah.
Because of a typhoon.
Well, yes. I think though that they would have had, they would have planned to have all of the family, you know, the women, the crops, everything on board. They weren't just fishing in a typhoon.
So if you suggest a planned migration, then they must have known where they were going and what they were going to find when they got here.
Well, yes, of course they didn't in the first instance. Well, obviously they couldn't have done. But if they ever got home and spread the word, you know, let's say they got from the Philippines to Guam or Saipan, okay. But if someone got back to the Philippines and said, right, there's all that land out there, then of course there would be a floodgate in a sense, I suppose, potentially. And I think this is quite important. Did they ever get back to spread the word? We don't know, but they might well have done.
So you believe that to be successful, it would have had to have been a planned migration?
Oh, yes, 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 yes.
Thank you, sir.
Well, in most cultures in the Pacific, women tend not to go in fishing canoes on a daily basis and go fishing. You know, it's not something that women commonly do in boats, and they might have done it in the past, but most ethnography wouldn't, doesn't suggest that. So you have to have some planning beyond just going out fishing, basically, I think.
One question.
Yeah.
I got a question. I'd like to direct it to Dr. Hung.
Yes, yes.
Okay. Dr. Hung, you can do English, no?
Yeah, we can.
Probably come up here. Dr. Hung, are you familiar with Dr. Wei Dong Sung? Dr. Wei Dong Sung, he just released a paper on the, what they call, from the University of Science and Technology in Hefei. Hefei, Hefei, is that how you say it?
About what topic?
The topic that he released the paper on was Chinese civilization was founded in Egypt. I wanted to throw that in there. Because he was breaking down the Sima Quan, is that how you say it? Sima Quan, the traditionally regarded Chinese founding dynasty between 2070 and...
Yeah, sorry, this is too far from my interest.
That's too far?
Yeah, I'm not expert
okay,
of this.
Okay, let me answer this other question.
Okay.
They say the word Formosa, right? Which is Taiwan, right?
Yes.
So, but the hill people of Formosa are Afro-Sino, right? They're very dark, they got curly hair, they got like Afros, like Melanesians, right?
No, they are Austronesian.
Austronesian?
Yes, they are Austronesian.
So,
they're like...
they're very similar in appearance to Chamorro people.
Yes.
Actually.
So
yes.
That would be, if you match them with what they call a Han Chinese, they're darker, taller.
Yes, slightly darker, but not very dark.
Well, when I say dark, I mean darker like this dark. You know what I'm saying? When you say Austronesian, a lot of people get mixed up. If you say Philippines, they think of Philippines like in Sino Negrito Philippines, you know, as opposed to Philippines like you said, like this man said, first it was the Negrito, then you had the influx of Sino, right, the Chinese, and then the population changed, right? The admixture, right? Right? So he just said, the thought was, they could have took the boats. But the Negritos are known for their maritime activities, right? Nobody don't want to say that one. And when you say Sulawesians, the black people from there, just like the Aborigines from where you're from, right? Australia and whatnot and New Zealand, they're known for their maritime history, right? Because some people would say the New Zealanders came down here. It was some people that wrote about that too. They were saying that they came down this way. My question is, when we look at this Rupia Pali, why aren't you like doing like look at that pottery and then look at some of the African pottery shares charts from like the Sudan? You know that face that he just showed, that Ulili? That mm-hmm. looks like an African mask to me. And I can bring you some data, just some photos, and it would look like some African mask to you. You see what I'm saying? You see what I'm saying, though?
I think, Okay, I think we're probably talking at cross purposes here. If what you suggest was the case, of course, then you would expect linguistic and DNA evidence, and well, there isn't any, basically. Yes, I'm sorry, I don't think it works. But I can see what you're, perhaps where you're coming from, but I it doesn't.
You said, when I was looking at this, you saw the emotion blood set, right?
Yeah.
Right?
But, perhaps we have to ask somebody else if they have any comments or questions. Yes, one here. Waves into Marianas, you mean? Do you want to answer that one?
Yeah, I think the translation is actually incorrect. It's not giants like 10 feet tall, it's giants like my size. And in Marianas, Spaniards at that time, the average height was about 5 feet or 5'2", right? And so someone like my height is in translation, a giant, right? Now, the archaeological excavations where we find burials, there's some people a little smaller than Dr. Holmes' size, and some people a little bit taller than me. So you have that whole range, males and females, in that size range, which is not much different from what we have today. And there's no population change in the biology. Linguistically, if there was a second wave of migration, then it didn't make an impact in the Chamorro language. The Chamorro language is definitely what we call Western Malayo-Polynesian. It's an early branch of the Austronesian languages. Everywhere else in the Pacific Islands is what we call Oceanic, so it's a different branch of the language. And there's some certain core words in Chamorro, and also in the way the grammar is structured and the kinds of sounds that you can make in the language that are not shared anywhere else in the Pacific. So if there was a second wave coming later, at a later time, then that would have definitely shown in the language. It also would have shown in the biology, which we don't have. And then the third point is in the archaeological record, that there's no break in the archaeological record. You know, it's continuous. And the things like the pottery styles change over time gradually, blending one form into the next, and they overlap, you know, for sometimes 100 or 200 or even 500 years, gradual changes. So that kind of gradual change over time goes against any knowledge of a population replacement. We do know there was population increase steadily over time. And we know that about 1,000 years ago, everywhere in the Pacific had this massive population explosion, you know, going everywhere. So there was much more cross traffic at that time, about 1,000 years ago, which is the beginning of the Lati period. So during the Lati period, yes, of course, there's much more cross contact, and with that comes greater diversity in the population, but is not what archaeologists would call a wave of migration, because remember, a migration like a founding settlement, you know, and taking over and dominating is a very different thing from people just having contact and trade, you know, across broad regions. So I hope that answered your question.
Yeah. Dr. Carson, on that point, right, the introduction of rice growing, which apparently occurred at about the same time as the appearance of the Lati stone. Doesn't this imply some change in the continuity of the structure of the community?
Okay. Well, we don't really know exactly when rice first entered the Marianas. We do know from linguistic clues, again, that it's definitely in the Malayo-Polynesian branch. So it must have actually been early. Culturally and historically, there's clues that it was used only on certain ceremonial occasions, perhaps. We're not exactly clear on that yet. And one of the reasons we have Dr. Deng Shengwang working with us is to help identify when we find the earliest rice. So we're not exactly sure of that just yet. So in that respect, the jury's still out. You know, we want to leave the door open for interpretation. A few years ago, we would have thought that, yes, rice, rats, and laddi, and these things all appeared at once. But now, we're learning that may not really be the case. So we're leaving the door open. I think there's other people who had some questions.
Thank you, Dr. Bellwood, and welcome to the Mariana Saturday. I have a question. The vessel where the baby was, where was that from?
The
vessel where they buried the child.
Oh, that was from Taiwan, a site near Tainan City in the southwest of Taiwan. You mean the jar on its side the child inside? Yes.
So that's from Taiwan.
That's from Taiwan. It's about 4,000 years old.
That's very interesting, because are you familiar with the recent archaeological study that's being done here in Anaguan, the village of Anaguan?
Well, Mike would be more familiar than I am with that. There are jar burials in Yap. I don't know if they've been found here.
This is Mike's area, I think.
Yeah, there's a vessel that a vessel buried right next to the mother that was found by the recent archaeologist from Scientific Consultants. So I wanted to find out if you're familiar. Is there any?
There's no direct connection, because the one you mentioned, Peter, was about 4,000 BC or
years ago.
Yeah, it's about 2,000 BC. The one you're talking about, like in the Best Sunshine findings, was about...
It's Anaguan Village.
Oh, sorry, Anaguan. Oh, that one. Okay, and Anaguan Village is...
1180?
Actually, I think it's a little bit more recent. But anyway, if it's 1180 year, that's still like 3,000 years different.
Yeah, I just wanted to see, because the migration, that's one. Also, he's talking about, you know, some of the Austronesian. And I noticed, having taken some of the Polynesian languages, I saw there's like a lot of our traditional or Chamorro words are very similar to Hawaiian, Tongan, and Samoan, for example, in the numbering system. If you say five in the traditional Chamorro, it'll be lima.
Yes, it's lima everywhere.
Right? Yes. And even mata.
Maka,
right?
Yeah.
And
Lani,
right?
Yes.
So how do you reconcile that? I just wanted to...
Well, that's all.
That's
the best
core vocabulary.
The Austronesian language family is relatively recent. It's only been spreading in the last 4,000 years. That's not very long. Language families like Indo-European are much older, or Afro-Asiatic, that includes enough Semitic and ancient Egyptian. So this is a fairly recent migration. So there are transparent similarities. In 1774, Captain Cook, on his second voyage with Johann Reinhold Forster, documented all of this in word lists. And I think they even had Chamorro word lists from what were those. In those days, they were called the Ladrones or something, right? The Islands of Thieves, I think, before they became the Marianas. So they knew all about this. Oh, yes, so words like lima, I mean, a lot of this core vocabulary for parts of the body is fairly universal. Numbers, I'm not so... You'd have to ask a linguist about this, but a lot of it's very widespread.
Dr. Carson, are any of the potteries that was found and the shirts that were found at Anaguan Village, the Best Sunshine site, are there any similarities with what...
No, not at all. The time difference is so great, and they're completely different.
So there's no carry on with that tradition?
No, the things that we were showing you was a tradition that lasted maybe 400 to 500 years, and then things change a bit after that. No, slowly, these gradual changes. So if we were to look at, say, the last 1,000 years at the Bapo site, House of Taga, any site in the Marianas, the pottery would look the same as what you're talking
like,
about.
Like Taga site, right? Maybe that'll be more similar, no?
Well, no. Every site in the Marianas within the time period you're talking about is a shared tradition, like in the last 1,000 years that thickened rim pottery. But in the earlier time periods, things are much different. It's a thinner pottery, it's a smaller vessels, the red slip. And we find that in a number of sites, but Anigua or parts of Garapan, many of these sites that we know today were completely under the sea at 1000 BC. These sites didn't even exist. So it took much longer for those places to be inhabited. And then by the time those landforms and beaches did exist and were stable above sea level, like people living like where we are right now, things are much different. That was about 1,000 years ago, about the year 1,000 to 1200 AD, and a very different kind of culture had developed by that time. So things change over time, in other words.
Thank you.
With regard to the sea level, you're saying 1,000 BC sea levels were a lot higher. Is that because of ice age things?
Yes. This is all related to climate change, right? So, like 10,000 years ago would have been the end of the ice age, with when the polar ice caps and ice sheets melted, released these huge amounts of water into the oceans, and sea level rose dramatically. But that was a very, very long time ago. And then things fluctuate a bit, like on a pendulum. You can imagine it just takes time for things to stabilize in the ocean. So at the time when people first came to the Mariana Islands at 1500 BC, the sea level was higher than it is today, by a little more than my height, higher than today. And then starting about 1000 BC, it started to what we call a drawdown, to its present level. So for the first few hundred years that people were living in the Marianas, sea level was higher. But during that time when they were learning to live in this new environment is when things were changing in exactly the environment, where they were living on the coast. Things started to change and more of these beaches started to become available after 1000 BC. So that's another thing that's been challenging about finding these early sites. They're not in places where we would look today for sites. They're underground and inland. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. You mentioned that the original peoples that were encountered by the Australis that came from China, during the last glacial maximum, about 18,000 years ago, I believe. Is that the conventional idea that the original peoples walked to?
Yeah, well, they wouldn't have. They wouldn't have been able to walk all the way, right?
No. Australia's never been land bridged. That's why it's got kangaroos and wombats and koalas. The Alfred Russel Wallace in the mid 19th century travelled around in what is called Wallacea by biogeographers between Sulawesi and the Philippines and the eastern Indonesian islands and Nusa Tenggara and Timor. They're all in this intermediate zone of separate islands. They're all sort of oceanic islands with deep sea between them. However, Borneo, Java, Sumatra, of course, were part of Asia and Bali, and New Guinea and Australia were joined together with, New Guinea and Australia and Tasmania. But between, sea passages, many of them, up to about 90 kilometers wide, so they had to cross lots of sea. The first Australians had to cross sea. How they did it? We don't know. They perhaps floated on rafts. They wouldn't have had canoes like the Austronesians had, because this is 50,000 years ago. Distances are much shorter than getting to the Marianas, yes. But still, you've still got to cross about 100 kilometres. But of course, at certain times of the year, seas in that latitude along the equator are very, very calm. So if you're sitting on a log and paddling, I suppose, if you're energetic enough, you can probably get quite a long way. That's all we know, basically.
I want to add a little bit to that. In that region of island Southeast Asia going all the way to Australia, those islands are not separated by very far. You would be within sight of land, all the time. Right? So that's another factor to consider. And the longest crossings were maybe 100 to 120 kilometers. When you compare that to more than 2,000 kilometers coming to the Marianas, it's a different world. Do we have time for more? Do we need to have time? Yes.
Two questions. How do you know where to dig? And the other question is there any evidence of Lali stones in Indonesia?
Okay, let me answer that Ladi one first, and then I'll get it, because it's easier to answer that one first. Ladi are unique to the Mariana Islands. You don't find them anywhere else. Made of stone, right? As Professor Bellwood can tell you, the stilt raised houses, you know, on wooden posts are common everywhere in the world, almost. In some places, there's these wooden discs that are put on top. Now they have a hole inside that's like a rat guard, and you find those in many parts of East Asia and in Indonesia and the Philippines as well, and also this is another part of the Austronesian language tradition. You know, as the word we use haligi just means a house post, right? So if you go to other parts of in the Austronesian world, they would use the word haligi to mean a wooden house post. So this is another reason why we know there's this connection. But making it of stone and having it as a capital resting on top is unique to the Mariana Islands. You don't see it anywhere else. And there was another question about the second wave migration. That's another reason why you can't say that came from somewhere else, because it doesn't exist anywhere else. We'll get to the end just a minute. Your other question was, how do we know where to dig?
Yeah.
Okay. It's taken a long time to develop this, but now that we have good information about sea level changes, and we've dug enough by trial and error in different places and know how deep these sedimentary units are, we've been able to make, you know, like computerized models, you know, of the islands. I've done this for Guam and Saipan and Tinian, and Rota is a little more complicated because of it has a different kind of geology and some actual uplift and tilting involved. So we've yet to do this in Rota, but we can model and get, you know, an idea of the places where we should look, and they tend to be 100 or even 200 meters inland from today's shorelines and 2 or 3 meters deep. You know, I'm not even 2 meters tall, so that gives you an idea of what we're talking about. So at 1500 BC, the islands are much smaller than they are now, right? We just didn't have these big coastal plains. So the sites are necessarily in places where you wouldn't ordinarily look. If you were to do what we call a surface survey looking for Ladi sites, you would find Ladi sites, and if you dug underneath them, you would find Ladi period material that's up to 1,000 years old, but you would not find these kinds of sites that we're talking about. It's a completely different context. And Leanna, you had
one more question.
Thank you. I wanted, because I was looking at Dr. Bellwood's migration pattern theory, and several months ago, Humanities sponsored Dr. Miguel Villar, a genome study from the National Geographic. And he was saying, he was showing a migration pattern of the genome study DNA that's coming from Sulawesi. And I'm looking at your theory, so I just wanted to see what do you comment on that as compared to the Cagayan.
It's based on hair sample.
Sorry, who is coming from Sulawesi? The Chamorro?
Yes. I
don't know the study. If it's mitochondrial DNA, then we know, of course, in Europe that the replacement. Mitochondrial DNA is very subject to genetic drift, natural selection, because it's a very fundamental part of the human genome. It creates power within the cells, and it's very, very important. But we know from European Neolithic and later archaeology that there have been huge sweeps, that you cannot read the prehistory of Europe from the mitochondrial DNA of the living people. That is now, people thought you could 20 years ago. We now know you can't. You have to have ancient DNA that has survived in quite large quantities in places like Spain and Germany and parts of Central Europe, and now, of course, Western Russia, a lot of it, and the Ukraine, a lot of it is turning up. So I don't know, but basically. To me, Sulawesi is, of course, a potential possibility. The Chamorro, as far as I know, have a different mitochondrial haplogroup from the Polynesians. It's somewhere within the E haplogroup, I think, isn't it, in the majority. That, of course, is very common in many parts of Southeast Asia, various kinds of E. Exactly which kind came here, I don't know. So that's all I can say really on that.
E1 and E2.
But the genomic study of the Harvard one that I mentioned certainly wouldn't derive people from the Sulawesi in particular. Although, of course, that study didn't consider the Marianas. That was a much more broader whole region study. So we don't really know. I still think the Philippines are perhaps the most likely in terms of the linguistic connections that are suggested, the archaeology, and I suppose the geography, basically, unless they came through islands to the south like Palau and Yap, for which we don't really have any clear archaeological evidence at the moment. That's really all you can say.
Thank you, Dr. Bellwood, Dr. Carson, and Dr. Hung. This has been part of the Northern Marianas Humanities Council's ongoing community lecture series. And on your way out, you can grab a copy of our calendar for CNMI Humanities Month to know what other events we have coming up. Thank you for spending your Tuesday night with us, and have a great evening.
Should look, and they tend to be 100 or even 200 meters inland from today's shorelines, and 2 or 3 meters deep. You know, I'm not even 2 meters tall, so that gives you an idea of what we're talking about. So, at 1500 BC, the islands are much smaller than they are now. Right? We just didn't have these big coastal plains, so the sites are necessarily in places where. You wouldn't ordinarily look. If you were to do what we call a surface survey looking for Lati sites, you would find Lati sites, and if you dug underneath them, you would find Lati period material that's up to 1,000 years old, but you would not find these kinds of sites that we're talking about. It's a completely different context. And Leanna, you had
one more question.
Thank you. I wanted, because I was looking at Dr. Bellwood's migration pattern theory, and several months ago, Humanities sponsored Dr. Miguel Villar, a genome study from the National Geographic. And he was saying, he was showing a migration pattern of the genome study DNA that's coming from Sulawesi. And I'm looking at your theory, so I just wanted to see what do you comment on that as compared to the Cagayan.
It's based on hair.
Sorry, who is coming from Sulawesi? The Chamorro?
Yes. That's a theory. I
don't know the study. If it's mitochondrial DNA, then we know, of course, in Europe that the replacement. Mitochondrial DNA is very subject to genetic drift, natural selection, because it's a very fundamental part of the human genome. It creates power within the cells, and it's very, very important. But we know from European Neolithic and later archaeology that there have been huge sweeps, that you cannot read the prehistory of Europe from the mitochondrial DNA of the living people. That is now, people thought you could 20 years ago. We now know you can't. You have to have ancient DNA that has survived in quite large quantities in places like Spain and Germany and parts of Central Europe, and now, of course, Western Russia, a lot of it, and the Ukraine, a lot of it is turning up. So I don't know, but basically. To me, Sulawesi is, of course, a potential possibility. The Chamorro, as far as I know, have a different mitochondrial haplogroup from the Polynesians. It's somewhere within the E haplogroup, I think, isn't it, in the majority. That, of course, is very common in many parts of Southeast Asia, various kinds of E. Exactly which kind came here, I don't know. So that's all I can say really
it's
on
like
that.
E1 and E2.
But the genomic study of the Harvard one that I mentioned certainly wouldn't derive people from the Sulawesi in particular. Although, of course, that study didn't consider the Marianas. That was a much more broader whole region study. So we don't really know. I still think the Philippines are perhaps the most likely in terms of the linguistic connections that are suggested, the archaeology. And I suppose the geography, basically, unless they came through islands to the south like Palau and Yap, for which we don't really have any clear archaeological evidence at the moment. That's really all you can say.
Dr. Carson and Dr. Hung. This has been part of the Northern Marianas Humanities Council's ongoing community lecture series. And on your way out, you can grab a copy of our calendar for CNMI Humanities Month to know what other events we have coming up. Thank you for spending your Tuesday night with us, and have a great evening.